Dr. William Chunstuddy is our risk education specialist, and he's prepared this topic. And joining him is Arthur Blincy, our Vice President for Risk Management Education. So welcome, Bill and Arthur.
Good afternoon and good morning, depending on where you are.
And welcome once again to our webinar series.
I'll turn things over to you.
Thank you. Arthur, I passed by a school recently and I saw this soccer goal. What was happening there was quite interesting. One by one, the boys on the playground, looked like a third or a fourth grade class, were running as fast as they could at an angle up the back of the goal to see how high they could get. It seemed mostly harmless, but was probably an activity they shouldn't have been engaged in. What was interesting was the sign on the back of the goal. I'm sure that the sign was, the school was practicing due diligence by placing the sign there to minimize unsafe conduct. And there may have been some real potential dangers there. The sign read, "Do not climb or sit on the goals."
Well, that's nice that they had a sign there, but did you see any teachers there?
Well, I made a point of looking around to see if anyone was supervising. At first, I couldn't see anyone. But finally, I spotted them, two of them, up against the side of the school building, standing in the only shaded area on the playground. Now, I bring this up only to point out that supervision doesn't just happen because adults are present. Supervision is a deliberate safety activity that must be understood, coordinated, and properly implemented in order to minimize the risks to our children, our youth, and our church property.
So, Bill, how would you define supervision?
Well, I know that when we think of supervision, we usually think about simply having enough adults on a mission trip or maybe having adequate staffing overseeing our children's activities, kind of just enough warm bodies, but that's certainly not all there is to supervision. Supervision is the diligent oversight by qualified individuals in adequate numbers for the safety, security, and education of our children and youth. Our children must be protected from the physical dangers, environmental dangers, external dangers, and sadly, the human dangers from both within and without the church. It's a vital ministry of the SDA Church.
I think we would all agree that supervision is necessary for our children and youth who have yet to really gain the maturity to make the best decisions for themselves. But these aspects of supervision that you have here listed, how do we really understand them?
Well, indeed, Arthur, supervision also pertains to the protection of our children from adults who have poor judgment or inappropriate motives. And one other aspect of supervision that I'll interject here is that some may not have considered that proper supervision should never put the supervising adult in a compromising position or in danger of falling victim to false accusations.
So an adult could have an accusation brought that they were negligent in their supervision or in their conduct while supervising?
Well, I think we'll get to some case files, or we'll talk about case files very soon, but that's really true. Negligence in supervision is a problem.
Well, that's probably because we live in this litigious society. And when we consider supervision, shouldn't we really just rely on the parents to take care and supervise their own children?
Well, we know that it really does take a village to raise our children, and the church is certainly part of that village. As we think of the many areas that our church required to supervise, we should consider things that come to mind when we think of our parents. Parents today are faced with challenges that us older parents and grandparents really couldn't have imagined. As a result of their busy lives, not all parents fully understand their parenting responsibilities, and the shortcomings of parents fall on the supervision team. Now, parents generally trust supervision leadership, so we must not betray that trust. Parents can't always be with their children, especially if they have infants. As a result, parents don't always know where their children are at Sabbath school and church, and they trust us to be responsible for them. Even if they are with their children, some parents do not supervise their children and other children appropriately. They simply don't understand the concept of proper supervision. And once their children leave the cradle role division, many parents do not continue to accompany or assist their children's Sabbath school. Consequently, many divisions are left with understaffed Sabbath school divisions.
You know, Bill, I also remember a situation where the parent themselves was leading out in the church program that was taking place.
Mm-hmm.
So how could you really expect the parent to supervise their young child and what they were doing when here they were leading the congregation in the ministry activity themselves? You know, supervision takes on so many different aspects. And what you've pointed out here are some good thoughts, but I know you've also been really digging into some of our files. What kind of things do you find when you check our claims files as it relates to supervision?
Well, that's right, Arthur. I recently looked into a number of case files here at Risk Management involving claims that were based upon inappropriate or illegal contact between individuals. And interestingly, the number one lesson that was learned from the review of these files was inadequate, inattentive, or inappropriate supervision.
And that costs the church dearly. Not only in the loss of funds to pay claimants, but also in the loss of the reputation of the church, the reputation of the adult who may have failed in supervising an activity. And it's important to really understand, how does this fit into the church's ministries program?
Well, it's important that we recognize that supervision is a part of a broader safety program of a church. To do our safe due diligence, supervision really needs to be defined and clearly implemented as part of a larger practices and procedures of the local church. Guidelines should be written, understood, adopted, and followed.
And may I even add there, trained. You know, I think so often we just assume that an adult knows how to supervise a child. And that is a very dangerous assumption for any church to make. But why aren't all adults qualified to supervise?
Well, as we look at a supervision in a church safety program, we really do have to consider carefully the personnel and the personnel qualifications. Not everyone is cut out to be a supervisor of our children or youth, and some individuals may actually be harmful to children if left alone with them. However, that being said, most adults with mature, sound judgment can assist in the supervision process. But we should especially be careful in assigning supervision duties to our older teens and young adults. These action/consequences portions of particularly the male brain develops much later than that of the female, sometimes as early as their late 30s. So caution and even oversight of young adult supervisors is recommended. Also, most teens and young adults are closely tied to their smartphones. That's an issue that we'll talk about later. In order for our churches to be truly the safe places that we want for our children, we can't take for granted that all those who volunteer are safe for our children. Consequently, the North American Division has taken action to assist churches in both the training and the screening, as you mentioned, of church volunteers. Now, Arthur, you were instrumental in moving this process forward for the benefit of our North American churches. Can you tell us just a bit about that?
Well, in 2010, the Seventh-day Adventist Church added some language into the church manual that said all individuals who work with children should be properly screened and trained on how to conduct themselves appropriately when they are engaged in the ministry with children. And here in North America, we have established a program with an organization called Shield the Vulnerable, which gives us an online training and background screening platform for these adults who do work with children. And it's very quite simple that the conference would refer these individuals to a secure website where they register in by the by their church location, by the type of volunteer position that they have in the church, and then they are taken to an online classroom that gives them the background training necessary to really recognize some key elements. Number one, how to appropriately interact with a child. You know, how do we physically interact? How do we talk with a child? How do we supervise a child's behavior appropriately? Secondly, it talks about the signs that an adult needs to be able to recognize in the event a child is in some type of an abusive relationship, and the reporting requirements that the law may demand that that adult follow to protect the child from a harmful, abusive situation. And then thirdly, it gives training in what is the expected code of conduct of an adult as established by the North American Division. And this way, we can have our adult volunteers and employees who work with children actually trained in what does the church expect of them when they are supervising a children or youth ministry function. And then the adult is, after they complete the course, taken to an encrypted website where they put in their own personal information so that the church can have a criminal background check run on that individual, the results of which come back to the conference office, who makes the determination whether or not an adult is eligible for service in the position that they have volunteered for. It's really quite simple to take care of. It's economical for the conferences to have this training and background check tool. And I'm sort of excited that by thus far there's 37 conferences who have deployed the Shield the Vulnerable program here in North America. And right now we have over 27,000 adults in the program who have been trained. And our goal over the next year or so is to hopefully have over 100,000 adults trained and screened by using this Shield the Vulnerable tool. So it's really pretty exciting.
That is really awesome. If they wanted just brief information about that right now, where should they go?
Well, probably the best place would be to go to our website under the Child Protection Resources section. You see the three smiling children. Whenever you see those three kids, click on them, and it will take you right to that area of our website.
That's really awesome. Additionally, though, churches really need to establish for their supervisors some ground rules and best practices for all the supervision areas that they have. And some of those are obvious, but some aren't. For instance, smartphones. Leave your cell phone in your pocket. Unless you can determine that it maybe is an emergency call, let the calls go to voicemail. If you absolutely need to take the call, ask an adult that's near you to supervise while you take the call. If no other adult is nearby and you know that it is an emergency call, do your best multitasking, keeping your eyes scanning the children while you briefly respond. But one of the worst is texting. Texting and supervision just don't mix. Texts can always wait. You can't look at children and your phone at the same time, and when you're texting, your mind's focus is always distracted. You need to focus on any potential dangers that may be near or activities that the children are involved in. And this seems obvious, but it's really not. You need to be there. You need to be there mentally. Be in the room or wherever the activity is. A wandering mind just isn't helpful. Leave your personal concerns at the door and focus on safety. You should really have the mindset of a swimming pool lifeguard. Try to always have another adult nearby. If a child or youth requires medical attention or maybe extended personal attention, the safety of the remaining children should never be compromised. Never be alone in an enclosed room with a single minor. It is for your protection against false accusations, and these are things that are covered in the coursework that Arthur mentioned. And if a child needs to go to the bathroom, it's always wise to have a same-sex adult to accompany them and stand outside the door if it's just a single toilet. But if it's a bathroom with multiple stalls or multiple urinals, the adult should stand just inside the exit door. Another area that we need to look at for stewardship is the area of liability. Arthur, tell us about liability.
Well, liability arises when the church breaches its duty to another individual, be that a child who is not appropriately supervised, can be harmed, a duty to a parent that has an expectation that when they entrust their children to us, that they will be appropriately supervised, and also the area that the public has, that we as good stewards of our facilities are going to, in a way, supervise and maintain these facilities in a safe condition so that as they come on our premises, they are not injured in any way caused by an accident. And when this duty is breached, quite often the church can be held liable for the injuries that result or the monetary damages that have been caused. And Bill, I know that this is really an area where we have to give some real focus in, and you've been doing this study again in our files, and you've been a pastor.
Mm-hmm.
So tell us, from a pastor's viewpoint, where should we really be looking at in our churches?
Well, I'll start with what we call common areas, areas where everyone tends to go for church, Sabbath school, areas that we would sometimes just consider public as well. Let's start with the sanctuary. Now, the greatest need for sanctuary supervision usually occurs before or after church. And I would recommend that deacons make regular rounds to ensure that the sanctuary is secured and locked if possible when not in use. Sabbath school classrooms are many times troubling areas for supervision. But if you come early to prepare your classroom and you have a child, we start to have a potential for some problems. But adults should also should avoid being alone with children in rooms that have no viewable windows or window panels in the doors. So before and after Sabbath school, if possible, rooms should be open and visible to the outside. If there are no windows, and no windows in the doors, they should be left open if there are children in the room. If you're the only individual in the classroom, prop the door open to ensure its safety. Deacons should be able to assist Sabbath school leaders by simply being around. That will always help. Now, in cold climates or inclement weather, this can be a challenge if the only access door is to the outside rather than inside the hallway. But again, the presence of deacons or deaconesses passing through the classrooms will certainly add safety and security. Arthur, in your travels, you were describing to me a check-in, check-out system for Sabbath schools. Can you tell me what that's about?
Well, some of our churches in recent years have deployed an electronic database, sort of like an attendance program, where parents, when they bring their children, especially to Sabbath school or to a youth church type program, check them in, and they receive two name labels. One for the child, which includes the child's name, the parent's contact information, and some systems even include any medical allergies or conditions that the child may have that his ministry leader may need to know. And then also the parent receives a name tag, which is the pickup slip. And it's interesting, Bill, that this gives the church a database of who's at Sabbath school, who's at youth church. And at the end of these services, the parents return back to pick up their child, and the ministry leader can match the name of the child with the parent who has the pickup ticket to know that that child has been released back to their parent or guardian or an adult who the parents have designated can pick up this child. And it's a great way to monitor where our children are. Are they in the appropriate place? And if a situation occurs, the church has at their fingertips how to contact that parent, maybe by calling them on the cell phone or sending them a text message. It's all in one easy system. And it's a great tool for churches to consider.
And I've also heard that it's a secure way for parents that may have gone through divorce to be careful about having making sure the right parent picks up that child when those types of situations happen.
And let me also add, for vacation Bible schools, where the church may not know who are all these children who have come onto their premises because they're from the local neighborhood or a friend of some child at your church. So it's a good safety measure in many different ways.
That's really great. Other areas of a sanctuary or of a church that need to be considered are just simple things like hallways. Children love to run in hallways. Children should always be stopped from running in hallways because they create dangers for themselves and particularly maybe for senior members that could be run into. The last thing you want is for an old person to fall. That's a very, very, very challenging thing for many of our seniors. And these can be really teachable moments as we continue to train our children. Bathrooms is increasingly a problem for improper behavior. We, in our claims files, the situation of bathrooms comes up over and over and over. And it's even startlingly between small children, child on child. So it is really recommended that, again, the same-sex adults should regularly pass through bathrooms, and the mere presence of a deacon or deaconesses will certainly discourage inappropriate behavior in bathrooms. One overlooked area is parking lots. And as you walk around a parking lot, there are many areas that are not easily visible from the church entrance. And our children and youth will many times find an out-of-the-way place or location to meet, rendezvous, or play, and just try to have a good time. And parking lots have many hidden areas behind bushes or large vehicles. Also look carefully at areas that can be accessed by outside individuals, or in some locations, animals that can create unsafe conditions for our children or adults. Include parking lots as a regular part of the area patrolled by deacons throughout the hours of all church activity. And then egress. Passing between buildings. Some church campuses have buildings that children and adults go to. And as they pass through these, generally no problem, but children can hide in places instead of going to where they're supposed to be. So deacons should patrol areas of egress, particularly paying attention to areas that are not visible from the regular egress pathways.
But Bill, shouldn't there be some areas that are just plain off limits?
Absolutely, Arthur. I think the first and perhaps the most obvious is the kitchen. Kitchen has a multitude of problems that can harm children. I think it goes without saying that we have to be very careful about letting anyone into the kitchen who does not belong there. Mechanical rooms is another one. Furnaces being lit. And a lot of times These are areas that are used for storage. The janitor closet almost always contains some sort of cleaning material that could very well be toxic for our children. These are areas that just need to be locked up. And the AV control room, it must always be supervised. I don't know, Arthur, if you want to mention a very serious incident that happened with one of our young people that was up there by themselves, and they were accessing pornography on a computer, and it accidentally got broadcast to the church.
I guess I didn't hear that wonderful story.
At any rate, it was a tragic thing, really a tragic thing, and it was all because it was not properly supervised. We got to keep the kids, particularly, out of the baptistries. If there's water, it's a drowning hazard. If it's not, it's just not an area that they need to be in. And of course, the offices of the church. And if you have a large campus, particularly that has a number of facilities, when they're unattended, the children need to stay out of the fellowship hall. Anyone needs to stay out of the fellowship hall that doesn't belong there. The mother's room is another area that you have to guard against, particularly with children going in and playing. Mothers need that space, and they need the quiet. Churches that are located near schools will often have gymnasiums, playgrounds, and outlying areas that have dangers that really our children just need to stay away from. Now, I put roof on here for a specific reason. Arthur, you mentioned to me one time an experience you had about a church roof. Would you share that with us?
Well, Bill, you know my son.
I do.
When he was probably in primaries or juniors, I came out of our church one Sabbath morning, and as I looked up, here was my boy and two of his buddies on the roof of the fellowship hall.
On the roof.
Having a great time.
Wow.
Seeing his dad, of course, they sort of stopped like deer looking in a headlight. And as I commanded that he come down off the roof immediately, and I met up with him and his two buddies, I asked the question, "Mike, how did you get up on the roof?" And he answered by saying, "Well, Dad, it's real easy." And he took me to a janitor's closet that had a ladder built into the side of the wall that went to a trap door that led to the roof of the church and the fellowship hall. He says, "Dad, the trap door is never locked, and neither is the janitor's closet." Which leads us to the lesson that our kids know every corner and hiding place and access point on our church premises, even better sometimes than the deacons or the pastoral staff.
That's pretty funny, but it really is serious. There are some other areas that we can touch on that if we had time, we could touch on today, but our time doesn't really allow us to look at these. What I would like to point out is that we have resources for other activities that the church are involved in, such as Pathfinders, travel, day trips, and overnight travel. Our community services is an area that always needs appropriate supervision. Mission trips, and I think as we learned today, there's a upcoming webinar that will be on mission trips. And of course, as you had mentioned, Arthur, Vacation Bible School. For information and resources on the appropriate safeguards, you really do need to get to our website, www.adventistrisk.org, and there are many, many resources there that can be very helpful for supervision and understanding of supervision in these areas.
You know, Bill, we've talked about real church activities, but what about supervision during the unstructured time or off hours? You know, a ministry leader needs to go to the church to prepare maybe for Sabbath school this coming Sabbath, and so they bring their two or three kids along, and what can happen then?
That's really true, Arthur. And again, going through the case files, many activities happen during these off hours. It's easy to let our supervisory guard down during these off hours. And as I mentioned, many of the claims have happened during these off hours. Supervision of off hours is a segment of the Sabbath day that must be considered crucial in any church safety program. Churches with large complexes should consider installing locked doorways in areas that are unused during off hours. Young people seem to kick in their energy into high gear after church is out and lunch is finished, so supervision must also be kicked into high gear. Many youth programs start mid-afternoon, and consideration must always be given to the supervision of the entire church facility, particularly where there is free access before, after, and during these activities. And it is also naive to believe that the youth pastor can handle the supervision by himself. Parents and deacons need to help the supervisory burden of our youth activities. And if adults have a meeting or a seminar in the afternoon and no consideration is made for the children and youth, the church is simply inviting trouble. And the times to watch, before Sabbath school, we have teachers, as you mentioned, with children that come, and the children many times will run around the church while the teacher is preparing for their Sabbath school program. Deacons can certainly help in this area. In between services, we have an early service, we have a Sabbath school, we have a late service. But those down times, we need to really be on our guard. After church, before the potluck, as I mentioned, the kids are a little bit wired because they've been sitting reverently all during church. They may be hungry, and this is a time where if there's a school nearby, the children many times will run to the playground, or people are coming and going. So we need to supervise our playgrounds and our parking lots during these downtimes after church, but before potluck. And as I mentioned before, after potluck, but before the afternoon and evening meetings, we need to be always vigilant and always have a supervisory staff there. And then, of course, at the end of the day, we always need to have supervision until that last kid is gone. Now, that last kid can be problematic because it seems like there's always a kid waiting at the church for a parent that hasn't arrived. And we've been told we shouldn't be alone with a kid, and so it creates a little bit of a problem. But just as a word of caution, if you find yourself ever alone with a child, particularly one that might need a ride home, give the pastor a call or give the parent a call. Let them know that the child is with you alone and that you'll be taking the child home.
So, Bill, we've covered a lot of territory in this short webinar today, but how would you briefly summarize the key points that we need to take away about the having appropriate supervision in our church ministry programs?
I would start by saying that supervision must be a part, an integral part, of the church's safety program. Now, if the church doesn't have a safety program, well, they need to get started with that as well. And the guidelines must be established, and they must be enforced, obviously, in as much as is possible. And a very important one that you touched on, the personnel must be screened and trained. There must always be an adequate number of supervisors. And a deliberate, organized supervision program in your church, what it will do is it will provide the feeling of safety and security for all worshipers that we so earnestly desire when we go to church. And in order to help implement this, all the points in this discussion will be put into a paper that will be available along with this webinar that we've just presented. And again, the resources that are available to you at Adventist Risk Management, they are many and they cover many, many topics. So at this point, Arthur, I think we can ask David if there are any questions, if anyone had any questions, before we close out.